Good morning, students. I welcome you all for another lecture on the course Computer Architecture and Organization. In today's class, I am going to discuss about the Unit 3 in the course. The title of Unit 3 is Types of Instructions. In that introduction part, I would like to discuss in this class. In this introduction part, what we are going to learn is, we are going to learn about the features of ARM processors in detail. Right, I welcome you all once again for this lecture. So first of all, the full form of ARM is Advanced RISC Machines. The full form of ARM is Advanced RISC Machines. I hope you know the full form of RISC. RISC means Reduced Instruction Set Computer. This is the full form of RISC. So I hope you have some idea regarding to RISC systems. Your ARM processor is one type of a RISC processor. So the full form of ARM is Advanced RISC Machines. Now I am going to discuss about the features of this ARM. The first feature is, it is a 32-bit RISC processor. Here this 32-bit indicates word length of the processor. Word length of the processor. What is the meaning of word length? Word length means the number of bits recognizes or processes by a processor maximum at a time is called word length. For this RISC processors, that means for this ARM processors, the size of word length or word length is equal to 32-bit. The meaning of this one is, ARM processors can do their operations maximum on 32-bit, as well as it can transfer or receive maximum of 32 bits at a time because it has 32 data bits. I repeat once again, the meaning of it is a 32-bit RISC processor, it means it can process 32 bits at a time. That means it can do either arithmetic operation or logical operations maximum on 32 bits. At the same time, it can able to transfer or it can receive data bits at a time maximum of 32 bit because it has 32 data bits. That is the meaning of this 32 bit. And coming to the second feature, it has 32 bit address bus. That means the number of address lines this processor has is equal to 32-bit. With the help of this 32-bit address bus, it can able to address the maximum of memory is equal to 2 power 32. That means it can support total memory of size 4 GB. Because the 2 power 30 is equal to 1 GB and 2 square is equal to 4, the total memory addressed by your ARM processor with the help of 32-bit address bus is equal to 4 GB. And coming to the third one, it supports both little endian and big endian memory addressing. It is very, very important. Before discussing what the little endian and what a big endian is, I would like to add one more important point everyone has to remember. All Intel processors supports little endian memory addressing. I repeat my statement. All Intel processors supports little endian memory addressing. At the same time, all Motorola processors supports a big endian memory addressing. But coming to ARM processors, they supports both little endian as well as big endian memory addressing. Now first of all, what this little endian is, what big endian is. First, I would like to discuss about a little Indian, right? What a little Indian is, right? So first one is little Indian. What this little Indian memory address? So one thing you have to remember regarding to little Indian is always the lower order byte of a data goes to lower order address location of the memory, and higher order byte of the data always goes to higher order address location of the memory. This is one thing. So I took an example. Let you can assume this is a memory. These are the memory, and this is the location address is some 2000H, and this location address is 2001H. This location address is 2002H, this location address is 2003H, and so on. This location address is a 20A0H. This is let you finish. These are the different memory locations and their addresses. Let you finish. Each and every location can hold only one byte of information. That means each and every location can hold only 8 bits. For example, my data is some 6 byte data, 60, 30, 50, 80, 90, and ABH. This is a number of size 6 bytes. This is the first byte, second byte, third byte, fourth byte, fifth byte, and then sixth byte. We know that byte is nothing but a group of 8 bits. And we know that in our computer systems, the numbers are representing with the help of hexadecimal. So 2-digit hex number is equal to a byte. So here I have total 6 bytes of information. In these 6 bytes, always this AB is treated as least significant byte of my data. And this 60H is the most significant byte of data. As per little Indian memory addressing, always this lower order byte of a data goes to lower order memory location. That means the location whose address is a lower, into that location only this lower order byte of data goes. At the same time, higher order byte of a data always goes to higher order address memory location. So how this data goes, right? So first this ABH copied here. Next this 90H copied here, next 80H, next 50H, and so on. That means once you are observing this, guys, this 90H data is a higher order byte data compared to ABH. As per little Indian memory addressing scheme, always the lower byte of a data goes to lower order address. So that's why here ABH is a lower order byte, so it goes to lower order memory location whose address is 2000. The next one is a 90H, which is a higher order byte compared to ABH. That's why it will goes to a higher order memory location whose address here is some 2001H. So like this, always the lower order byte of a data goes to lower order address, and a higher order byte of data goes to higher order address. This is a one important point you have to remember regarding to little Indian. Coming to the second one, in little Indian memory addressing scheme, always the program accessing from the memory starts at the lower order address and it was ends at higher order address. That means, for example, now you can assume these are the instructions equivalent hex codes. So this is the first instruction. So here AB is, let you can assume first instruction hex equivalent code. 90H is the second instruction of your program. It's equal hex code. Like that, these are the instruction equivalent hex codes. So this is your program. This is your program. The first instruction always stored at lower order location in the memory, and the last instruction always goes to higher order memory location. In little Indian memory addressing scheme, these programming instructions we are accessed from the memory. In the process, we are accessing the first instruction from lower order address,
and we access the last instruction from higher order address.
That means accessing of the instructions from the memory, we start at the lower order end and we ends at higher order end. That means this is the way we are accessing the instructions from the memory. This is another important condition regarding to Little Endian. Here totally I talk about two important conditions regarding to the Little Endian style. The first one is always the lower order byte of a data goes to lower order memory location address, and a higher order byte of data goes to higher order memory location. This is the first condition. Condition number two is always the first instruction we stored in the lower order address of our memory, and the last instruction of our program must be stored in higher order address of the memory. That means your program accessing starts at the lower order address and it was ends at the higher order address. So this type of notations we can follow in all Intel processors. That's why what we can say is all Intel processors are Little Endian processors. All Intel processors are Little Endian processors because all Intel processors satisfies these two conditions. If we take the reverse for this, then obviously we can call as Big Endian style. In Big Endian style, always a lower order byte of a data goes to higher order address, and a higher order byte of data goes to lower order address. That means the 60H initially copied into this. This is the higher order byte. It goes to lower order address, and the next lower order byte goes to higher order address. That means 30H copied here, and next 50H copied here, and next 80H copied here. That means the data higher order byte always goes to the lower order memory location, and lower order byte goes to higher order memory location. This is one thing in Big Endian style. The second thing is the program accessing. The first instruction of program we have to store in higher order address, and the last instruction of the program we store in lower order address. Again, you take an example. This is your first instruction of a program. This is stored at 2010, and this is the last instruction of your program, which is stored in a 2000H. The accessing of these programming instructions are like this. That means always the first instruction of the program is stored in higher order address, and the last instruction of the program is stored in lower order address. This type of processing we observed in Intel Motorola processors. Motorola processors. But here we clearly mentioned that both the Little Endian and the Big Endian memory addressing schemes are supported by ARM processors. That's the meaning of this. And next one is memory is a byte addressable. Memory is a byte addressable. That means each and every memory location can hold only a byte information. I repeat my statement. Memory is a byte addressable. That means each and every memory location can hold only a byte of information. That byte we can address. That byte we can address. So that's the meaning of here a memory is a byte addressable. Fine. And next is memory is accessed only by load and store related instructions. It is very, very important characteristic for RISC processors. Because in case of RISC processors, to access the information from memory, that means either you transfer the information to the memory locations or we retrieve the information from the memory locations. In that case, just we are going to use only two varieties of instructions. One is a load instruction and second one is store instruction. I can give more clarity about what a load and what a store. You remember, friends, wherever the information was transferring from memory to CPU, such operations what we can call is load. That means whenever I retrieve the information from the memory to CPU registers, that occasion I can go and utilize the load related instructions. If I do a reverse, that means if I transfer the information from CPU to memory, then I can go and use store related instructions. I hope you understand. what a load instruction and what a store instruction. Now simply you remember like this. Always the load operations are nothing but the information was transferring from memory to CPU registers. And the store operations are nothing but the information was transferring from CPU registers to a memory. So in almost all of RISC processors, we can go and use only this load and store related instructions to communicate with the memory. But if you go for the CISC processors, along with this load and store, we have so many variety of instructions which are helpful to us to communicating with the memory. But here our ARM is a RISC processor so that to communicating with the memory, in the instruction set, just we have only two varieties of instructions. One is a load and second one is a store. Coming to the next feature, all arithmetic and logical instructions are operate only on the data which was present in processor registers or CPU registers. This is another important point regarding to RISC processors. In a RISC processor, operations are done at a faster rate. The reason for this is always the information is kept on the CPU registers. That's why here if I want to do either arithmetic operations or logical operations, the important thing is what are the data that is necessary to do that arithmetic or a logical operation. The data must be present in a CPU registers, that is the data registers. And coming to the next, it has a 16 32 bit registers along with 15 bankered registers. Those are registers also, each one size is a 32 bit. I repeat my statement. It has total 16 32 bit registers labeled from R0 to R15. In addition to this, it has another 15 more banked registers. And here important thing is, this register R15 we call as a program counter PC. You remember friends, in this register R15 we can call as program counter PC. Each register size is a 32 bit. So out of these 16 registers, register R0 through R14, these are 15 registers are act as general purpose registers, GPRs. I'm already told you it has total 16 registers. Each register size is a 32 bit. Those registers names from R0 to R15. In that register R0 through R14, we consider as a general purpose registers. If you want to call a register is a general purpose, those registers can hold either memory addresses or data formats. Here important thing, if you want to call a register is GPR, that register is able to hold either addresses or it can able to hold a data. And one more point you have to remember regarding to this GPRs. The GPRs of a processor we treated as the scratch pad of the processor. That means those are registers area we can go and use according to user interest. According to user interest, the user can use these registers to store either addresses or to store a data. So such type of registers, how many present in this ARM processor is a total 15 registers. Those registers means from R0 to R14. But here another important thing is, in this R13 and R14, these are two important registers. In GPRs itself, R13 and R14 have some other function. This R13 we consider as link register LR. R13 register we can call as link register LR, and R14 we consider as stack pointer SP. R14 we consider as a stack pointer SP, and R13 we consider as a link register LR. Along with R15 is treated as a program counter PC. I hope you know that the functionalities of program counter PC as well as stack pointer SP, and here we need a the functionality of LR, link register. This link register is helpful to us to shift the program execution
sequence from one location to other location to link that with the help of this linker register. So out of total 16 registers which are frequently existed in ARM processors, R15 is act as a program counter PC, R14 is act as a stack pointer SP, and R13 is act as a linker register LR. Along with that, it has another 15 banker registers are present. 15 banker registers. These are 15 banker registers not always present in the system. These banker registers are present in the system depends on the mode of operation of your processor. Because your ARM processor operates in 7 different modes. Your ARM processor operates in 7 different modes. Based on mode of operation, this bank register comes onto the picture. And again, each and every bank register size is 32-bit. Along with all these registers, again it has one more important one is a 32-bit status register. Here, a 32-bit status register is called as CPSR, Current Program Status Register. The full form of this is CPR. CPSR means C represents current, P represents program, S represents status, R represents register. CPSR means current program status register. Along with that, it has another bank of registers to hold this status information. Once we are shifting from one mode of operation to another mode, there we have a SPSR registers are present. SPSR. SPSR means saved program status register. Again, one more time, I'll discuss about this. That is, our ARM processor has a 32-bit status register, which we can call as a CPSR. CPSR means a current program status register. In addition to this, it has another bank of status registers are present. Those status registers are used or comes onto the picture based on mode of operation. Those status registers, what we can call is SPSRs. SPSR means saved program status register. This ARM processor operates in 7 different modes. Based on mode of operation, bank registers and SPSRs comes onto the picture along with our R02 R15. That is important. Now we can go and see what are the internal bits or internal bits of our current program status register CPSR. Right, we can go and see the bit format of this. So see here, this is the bit format of our current program status register CPSR of our ARM processor. Total size is equal to 32-bit. Out of 32-bit, the useful bits for us is only 12-bit. The useful bits are only 12-bit. Rest of 20 bits are reserved. Rest of 20 bits are reserved. So in this case, the useful bits, least significant 8 bits, that is bit 0 to bit 7. Those 8 bits we consider as control bits. In this control bits, the least significant 5 bits are considered as mode selection bits. M02, M4. I'm already told you, our ARM processor operates in 7 different modes like user mode, system mode, undefined mode, abort mode, FIQ mode, IRQ mode, and about like this, there are 7 different modes. In order to operate our ARM processor in any one of these 7 modes, then we took the help of this bits M02, M4. By using different bit configuration over this M02, M4, we can operate our ARM processor in 7 different modes. And next bit is a T-bit. This bit is used to change the state of operation of your processor. Because your ARM processor operates in 2 different states. One state is called a thumb state. One state is called a thumb state. and another state is called ARM state. To change our state of operation of our processor either from ARM to thumb or thumb to ARM, we took the help of a bit T. Generally, our processor operates in ARM state. If you want to shift our state of operation of processor from ARM to thumb, simply we turn on, that means you make T is equal to 1. If you make T is equal to 1, definitely we change the state of operation of our processor from ARM to thumb. In ARM case, each and every instruction size is a 32 bit, but if you go to the thumb state, every instruction size is a 16 bit. That means we compress a 32 bit instruction into a 16 bit instruction without disturbing its functionality. The function is same, but only the difference is in order to reduce the code size. In order to reduce the code size for any particular application program, then we shifted to thumb state. There we are using only thumb instructions. That means this processor has two different types of instruction set. One is ARM instruction set and second one is thumb instruction set. Only the difference between these two is, in case of ARM instruction set, every instruction size is 32 bit, but in case of thumb instruction set, every instruction size is only 16 bit. There is no variation in the sizes of the instructions, either in ARM instruction set or it is in thumb instruction set. Only the functions have changes, but the instruction length was a constant. Because this is a RISC processor. Another important characteristic of a RISC processor is the instruction size was a fixed. That's why in ARM instruction set, instruction size is a 32 bit, but in case of thumb instruction set, instruction size is just only a 16 bit. Why it is called a thumb? If you are observing our fingers, the width of thumb is somewhat a bigger one. But its size is less compared to remaining fingers. But we can call this is also a finger, like this. In case of thumb instruction set, the same instruction was a compressor to 16 bit. So that's why in order to change the state of operation of our processor from ARM to thumb or thumb to ARM, we took the help of T. Next are 2 bits, I and F. This F bit is for FIQ disable bit. FIQ means fast interrupt request mode. In order to disable fast interrupt request, then I took the help of this F. This F bit is set to 1, automatically we disable FIQ mode. FIQ mode means fast interrupt request. That means in this FIQ mode, we are providing the services for the interrupts who have highest priority. The interrupts who have highest priority, those interrupt services we are done in case of FIQ mode. To disable that FIQ mode, we simply make F is equal to 1. Next one is I, that means IRQ disable. That means IRQ means interrupt request mode. This is another mode. In this mode, we are simply providing the services for the normal interrupts who have lowest priority. To disable that mode of operation, I took the help of this I bit. By making of this bit is equal to 0, I disable IRQ mode. These are the end control bits. Next, we are coming to a higher order 4 bits, we consider as conditional code flags or simply a status flags. These flags are automatically set or cleared based on the result produced by ALU. Here we have such flags as S only 4, V represents overflow, C represents carry, Z represents 0, and N represents negative. Negative in the sense it is a sign flag. And Z represents 0 flag, and C represents carry, it is also called as a borrow also. And V represents overflow. We know that. For what cases these flags are set to 1? We are already idea regarding to this particular conditional codes. These flags are automatically set or cleared. So this is our CPSR register. Again, I would like to mention one more point here. Out of total 32 bits of our CPSR register, the useful bits are just only 12 and remaining 20 bits are reserved. That means these bits are defined in advanced processors which are coming from ARM. I hope you understand all the features of ARM processors. In the next lecture, I'm going to discuss about addressing modes which are supported by ARM processors. That is another important topic, and that is an interesting one, because what are the addressing modes we discussed so far? Along with those addressing modes, your ARM processor supports a different varieties of addressing modes. Those are indexed addressing modes. In that case, we are going to discuss total 7 different addressing modes. Those are very, very important and more interesting. Those topic I'm going to discuss in next class. Thank you for patient listening.